Welcome back, guys. So the Warrior 64 from Intec Gaming, the pre-modded HDMI Nintendo 64 console currently available on Kickstarter, has been stirring up a lot of controversy as of late. And rightfully so. People really want to know what they're going to be getting their hands on, you know, what they're going to be getting themselves into. And recently, another YouTuber, you may know him, Metal Jesus Rocks, he did a video on this device. And in that video, it's pretty much, nope, no sir, don't like it. And that was very fair. So the product that he presented, he had some issues with the visuals and the saturation. And, you know, kind of disappointed a lot of people out there. Now, what I'm going to be talking about here is just what had been told to me concerning those products. Not Metal Jesus in any way, just the products that he received. I don't know what he was told. I don't know what he had received as far as emails had gone, but I had been in talks with this company for a little while as I have reviewed a few of their products in the past. And from what I understand, there is a guy who they hired as like a partner to work their marketing for online sales type of thing. And I'd actually dealt with that guy in the past, and this company has been kind of annoyed with him for sending out products without permission to send out products, right? So essentially what I was told is that the Warrior 64 consoles that Metal Jesus received were just really early prototypes that nobody was supposed to see, nobody was supposed to have access to other than a few members on that team. Like I said, I can't confirm that. That's just what was told to me. So if people really want to know, what does the final product look like? So I met with these guys and they gave me a couple units here of the Warrior 64 console. One that is the final product that will be shipped to anybody who backed the Kickstarter for the pre-modded console, which is going for $150. And then you do have those kits that they're selling to do it yourself, which are around $100. This is supposed to be what you will be getting. They also sent me another unit that's a little later prototype versus what Metal Jesus had taken a look at. Like I said, this is just the information that was presented to me. I can't confirm anything as far as any of that goes. But hey, you know, when you review a product and you receive a product, you just go off of what the company tells you as far as like, okay, here's the item. You look at it like, okay, this is what people will receive if they buy it. So let me give my honest impressions and thoughts on it. So that's what happened with that video. And I mean, who could blame anyone for that as far as what was presented there? But in this video here, we're going to be looking at what they state is the final product. And they told me that the difference between the final product and the previous versions of various different prototypes that they worked on has to do with the way they incorporated the board into the system. Now, as far as my talks had gone with this company in the past, they never presented it to me in the fashion that this is the same thing as the Ultra HDMI. But looking at their Kickstarter and some of the information out there, it did look like they were making some bold claims as far as their product versus an Ultra HDMI Nintendo 64. So I just wanted to point that out. I don't really think they had stated anything like that directly to me, but as far as the community goes and the information that's been put out there, some people may have that in their minds just with the way certain things are worded, the confusion that they had caused them, you know, themselves with the way they presented this product on their site or through social media, whatever the case may be. So I do have an Ultra HDMI modded Nintendo 64, and it's my preferred way to play Nintendo 64 games. I mean, nothing's going to change that. It's a very robust modification with on-screen display, tons of different settings, output resolution up to 1080p. And when this was first available, the Ultra HDMI mod, I believe you could buy the kit for around $150. Pretty much can't find it for that now. And then if you couldn't install it yourself, you could pay an installer to do so. And I think the average price was around $80 to $85. It's just the basic install, not doing any recaps or anything like that. So yeah, nowadays, if you want an Ultra HDMI modded console, you're going to be paying quite a bit of money. It's kind of ridiculous when you think about it, but that's just the way things work. Now, with the Warrior 64, this thing doesn't have all those options. It's just 720p. It does have an aspect ratio switch on the back, 16:9:4:3. That's a very nice addition. You still have access to the AV out port, but you have to have your expectations in check here. You can't compare this to the Ultra HDMI. There's just no comparing it. It's not the same solution. They're just different options. And the Ultra HDMI is like the best option. I mean, as far as my opinion goes, it is anyway. And I think part of the problem here with this Warrior 64 is the way it's been marketed, the way it's been spoken about. It should have never really been compared to the Ultra HDMI, causing that confusion that this, you know, this company's saying, hey, this is the same thing or very similar. Just because there's HDMI doesn't make it the same thing or very similar. So you do have to have those expectations in check there. And I think this is an item, a product that is geared more towards the casual market. People who don't want all those bells and whistles and all that stuff, you know. They just want to relive their youth and play some games. There's tons of options out there. And Warrior 64 can be an option, I suppose. But you have to make the best decision possible for what it is you're looking for, right? So with the Warrior 64, I do have to point out, looking at the new version, the one that they state is supposed to be the final build that is going out to the Kickstarter backers who ordered this, I noticed some things. So with the prototype version, the saturation was kind of high. And when things are oversaturated, especially when you see those reds, man, it starts to wash out details and it just does not look good. With the new version, they dialed that back. I think they got the saturation quite a bit more in tune with the way the hardware should look. But with that, I did notice something else here. So it does look a bit darker compared to the Ultra HDMI or even the prototype version or even just running the hardware through, you know, composite. So it is a bit darker. And when I went through my editing software, started messing around with brightness, it does appear that it is about 10 to 20% darker somewhere in that range than other solutions. So that's something I got to point out there. Can you tweak with that on your TV? Sure, if you have those settings, but me personally, I don't like doing any of that kind of stuff. I don't want to have specialized settings for each and every console that I play on my TV. Like, not a lot of TVs have tons of different profiles you could set up, so that's kind of a pain in the butt. I just want to plug it in and play. I don't want to tweak anything beyond what I've done for the TV in general, for, you know, like gaming mode as an example. But that does have to be pointed out. Now, one thing that I know a lot of people will be wondering about is input latency, lag. Now, I can't scientifically test this at the moment. I'm just not equipped to. But for me, always the thing is perceived input lag. What do I perceive? What does it feel like to me? I have to be honest here. Input latency with whatever this board is they're using and the way it outputs, I tested both the original Nintendo 64 through Ultra HDMI and the final build of the Warrior 64. And as far as my perception goes, there's definitely a bit of input latency here. Is it a lot? I don't know what the specific number is, nor do I really care that much. But once I compared the two, I did notice there is a little bit of input latency. But at the same time, I also feel that it's not something most people will perceive or even notice. But I did notice it only because of going back and forth between the two systems. It was a very little bit of a, you know, an amount, I guess you would say. So I just wanted to provide these details, the comparisons, the way everything looks, just to give people more of an idea of what you would be getting your hands on if you ordered one of these things. Do I think it's the most horrible product out there? No. Do I think it's perfect? No. Do I think it's, you know, an option? Of course, there's options out there for everybody. And you really have to take a look. $150 for a Nintendo 64 that they have refurbished, recapped, supposedly. That's what I've been hearing, that these consoles are being recapped because they've been refurbished and cleaned up and whatnot. So like I said, I cannot confirm everything that I have been told here. I can only provide you with what I'm seeing and dealing with and the information that's been provided to me. So do with that as you please, you know what I'm saying? Now, if you're interested, I'll put a link to the Kickstarter. Final thing I want to mention is the controller that they provided with these consoles, the Warrior controller, which they do currently sell on Amazon as well. I actually think the controller's not bad. It's pretty much a clone of the Hori Mini Pad. It's smaller than the Retrobit Tribute 64 controller, So keep that in mind. If you have them big hands, this controller may not be good for you, but it does feel fine to me. I don't really have an issue with it. It responds well. Not anything really negative to say about it. I think it's all right. But there you go. Really do appreciate you guys watching, hanging out with me on this video. Hope it helped. And with that said, we'll catch you guys next time. Peace out. Bye-bye and boom. Bye.